Senator Cornyn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I want to join those in applauding you and Senator Grassley, Senator Snow, Senator Bingaman, Senator Conrad, and Senator Enzi for your good work. I know it wasn't easy, and I know the six of you were under a lot of pressures, both internal and external. I think it's clear to me there is strong bipartisan recognition that our health care system needs reform, and this bill reflects a good faith effort to try to move us in that direction. Health care costs, as we know, have more than doubled for American families over the last decade. Seniors are counting on Medicare, but we also know it has $38 trillion of unfunded liabilities, about three times the national debt. Medicaid, we know, imposes huge unfunded costs on state taxpayers and produces unacceptably low outcomes for patients. And our current government health programs are riddled with waste and fraud and abuse to the sum of some $90 billion a year just for Medicaid and Medicare. And the fear of frivolous litigation has encouraged defensive medicine, which increases America's health care bills by some estimate up to 9% every year. And as we know, millions of people lack health insurance. We agree on the need to fix the system, and so I think there are some common sense solutions that we could all support, some of which are reflected in this bill, some of which are not. For example, making private coverage more affordable, realigning incentives to providers to focus on value over volume, creating incentives for patients to take better care of ourselves so we're healthier and more productive, and of course, cutting the waste, fraud, and abuse in our current entitlement programs. And I think these could be the core of a bipartisan approach. I'm sorry to say that despite your good work, this bill, as it currently stands, I think would make many of our current problems worse. And here are my specific concerns. First, this proposal would increase government spending at least $1.6 trillion over 10 years, according to one analysis. The $856 billion price tag, as we know, doesn't tell the whole story because it's not for a full 10 years of implementation, nor does it include the so-called doc fix, except for 1 year. When you start the clock in 2013, of course, the first full year of implementation, the bill goes up. And we know already that the American people are weary of excessive government spending, and they feel like Washington is not appropriately responsive to their concerns that we've seen on our TV screens and in town hall meetings across the country. Several studies have shown that middle-class families will see higher premiums because of the new taxes in the proposal. Premiums in the individual market would go up by 10%, according to one study. In my state alone, in Texas, in the individual insurance market, 91% of the current policies in place don't comply with the minimum actuarial value required under this bill. So, again, it's their costs are going to go up substantially. Small group insurance premiums would jump by 15% in Ohio and up to 25% in California, according to one study. Of course, this proposal also takes a big chunk out of Medicare. Any savings found in Medicare, I believe, should be dedicated to making that program solvent. This proposal cuts $125 billion out of Medicare Advantage, that now covers roughly 10 million seniors. And of course, if that passes in the current form, it would break President Obama's promise that people can keep what they have now if they like it. Medicaid, as we know, already imposes huge costs on state taxpayers and crowds out other priorities like education, law enforcement, and the like. In my state, the Texas Health and Human Services Commission has given me estimates that suggest that this proposal would increase Texas Medicaid costs by $20 billion over the next 10 years and expand the number of Texans on Medicaid by roughly 10%, 2.5 million more. Medicaid, of course, we know is an important program, but it demonstrably delivers poorer health outcomes than private insurance, and of course there's the $30 billion in fraud that I mentioned a moment ago. This proposal includes $350 billion in new taxes, not including the individual and employer mandates. We know that we're in the midst of a recession, hoping and praying for a recovery, but raising taxes during a recession is not the way to create jobs. We know that the proposal imposes a new tax for those who did not abide by the individual mandate. This new tax is as much as $950 a year for an individual and $3,800 for a family. The White House says this isn't really a tax, but I think that defies the question that if the IRS is going to collect it, what do you call it, if not a tax? For businesses, the employer pay or play provision is a huge burden. One grocery chain in my state estimates this provision would cost them $10 million in additional taxes. Most economists agree that the employer mandates have the effect of reducing wages and crippling job growth. When you put all the taxes and mandates together, the total bill over the next 20 years is more than $2 trillion. This proposal not only includes only a one-year fix for the physician payment under the Medicare program. The cost of future fixes, as we know, is not included during the entire 10-year budget window. This proposal outsources the future of our seniors' health care to an unelected government board. This board could reduce access to medical care with very limited congressional view, in other words, by rationing. On medical liability reform, as we've heard, this proposal includes only a sense of the Senate, when we have, as the President called for, demonstration projects, namely the laboratories of democracy, like Texas, where we've seen that bringing common sense medical liability reform dramatically brings down the cost of medical liability insurance and increases patients' access to doctors. With respect, Mr. Chairman, despite your outstanding efforts, this proposal has major flaws, and I plan to offer several amendments like my colleagues. But I think, in the end, my biggest concern is this proposal taxes too much and grows government too much. And I would hope, but I'm not optimistic, that this process, together with the marrying of this bill with the Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions Committee product, and as the bill moves across the floor, I'm concerned that it will not move more in the direction of more choice and lower costs, but one that will lurch to the left in a way that will result in higher costs and less choices for the American people. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.